It depends on who hears the word Edgewater as to what image or images it conjures up in one's head. If you were growing up in Sline in the 30s and the 40s and 50s, pleasant memories are sure to fill your mind. Edgewater was in its glory. It was the place to be, and it remained that place to be for several decades. However, if you were born after the mid-50s, not much would register. By the 1960s, Edgewater had served its purpose and served it well, but by the late 60s, not much was left that would reflect the once grand time that so many people had from the area. It would be hard to convince people today that beneath this new fill once stood a dance hall that held every big band in the country at one point or another, usually on their way to Detroit or Chicago or Cincinnati or New York. The big swing bands would stop off at Edgewater on a Sunday evening that was occasionally free, and huge crowds filled the dance floor. And on summer evenings, just as larger crowds gathered outside to hear the sounds of Goodman and Ellington and Dorsey's and Miller's and Armstrong, and the wooden window covers that covered the screens would be raised on Sunday evening, and the sounds would filter out across the parking lots and lake. I believe all of this to be true, but what I remember about Edgewater does not conjure up any fond memories. By the 1960s, when I could ride my bicycle to town, I would ride through the park and it was deserted. Not much was left to show its once grand eloquence. It seems like a grocery and a little bar still stood, but the rides were abandoned. They were still there, just idle. The 50-some cottages that were summer homes for so many people throughout the years were now run-down shacks. A few of them had been transformed into full-time residences, but all were in a state of disrepair. Edgewater, the dance pavilion, had an occasional dance in the 60s, but not from the big swing bands. That era was gone. They had bypassed Salina and Edgewater and Russell's Point for the larger gigs in the cities. But for those who witnessed it, as you will soon see, they saved the memories and preserved them and cherished them for a lifetime. Those we will share. But there was another period of time that about Edgewater that is slowly becoming clearer. That time began somewhere in the late 1890s, when Edgewater began as a summer retreat for people who could afford a summer home. We know that the park started somewhere in the early 1900s, and we found an article in the Daily Standard in March of 1899. Janelle Henderson will share that article with you.
The first cottage is approaching completion out at Edgewater Park. The cottages will all be located in the western part of the grove. The pavilion will be built next before the remaining cottages are completed. The baseball diamond, bowling alley, billiard hall, swings, and other items will be located in the eastern half of the grove. A bathhouse will also be built just where there is a broad stretch of gravel along the shore. A board pier will also be built where the steamers will land many times a day and where the fleet of small boats will be moored. The contractor, Gable, and his men are hustling the work through with all possible speed in order to be ready for the first installment of summer tourists who are expected to pour into Salina in a continuous stream all summer long.
park did not progress as rapidly as the 1899 article suggests. But we did talk to Lee Fisher, whose mother lived at Edgewater and whose grandfather managed the park in 1911 to 1914. And she wrote an article in December of 1984 that told of her accounts and the family's activities during the 1911-1914 period. Janelle will read it.
In March of that year, about 1911 or 1912, we moved to Edgewater Park, and Dad managed the park for Hamilton and Whitney from Lima, who were not related to us. Dad still carried the mail, and Mama took care of the cottages in the summer and chaperoned the young people. After 10 p.m., all parties were over and no fellows or girls were allowed to have their friends there. The day we moved to Edgewater, it was cold and gloomy. The old dance hall was east of our house, park house, and manager's office. Sis and I were young, and the old hall looked so large. There were metal boats tipped over and lying all over the large porch which surrounded the building. There were huge beams to hold the roof up. It was all open, and the wind and leaves would swirl all over the place. When Sis and I would talk, our voices echoed and it was scary. Later, we got used to it and even roller skated in there. Dad kept our buggy inside the dance hall to protect it from the weather. One time, the Easter Bunny left our eggs there. One nest was in our buggy back of the seat on the outside where there was a place like a car trunk. When we raised the lid and found this large nest, our eyes almost popped. There were 12 beautiful colored eggs with designs and stripes. The only way to get to school from this house was in a school hack pulled by a horse. It would pick us up on the dirt road at Jewish House, where the highway is now and where you turn to go to Huffy's factory. We walked on a path through the woods from our place to meet the hack. Mama would walk with us. The trees were so thick and large in those days, and Mama was often afraid of tramps because we were close to the streetcar track. The track ran close to the dance hall where Route 29 is now. I got homesick for my mother one nice spring while at school. Miss Cook had to get an eighth grade girl to take me home on the streetcar. I don't know how she got back to school because the cars did not run very often. I had cried and cried at school, but as soon as I saw my mother, I was all right. She took me out to our hammock and read to me. The hammock was hung on a large oak tree and then tied to a hook on the back of cottage number 9. My favorite trees were that oak and a large hickory tree in front of cottage number 11. Dad had put a large rope swing there for public use. Two other swing trees were east of the dance hall, a large walnut and a large oak near the car track, where you would now cross Highway 703. In those days, the cottages were always filled. The Rudabals and the Post Camps, the Hoaglands, Dr. Richardson, Mert Freeman, and the Yinglings all had their own cottages. We loved it there in the summer. A rich man and his wife, that is what we called them, drove down from Lima to camp several weeks. This was a thrill for all the kids because they drove an electric car, and they would take us for rides. It was a one-seated car, and we all had to take turns. Families came also from Cincinnati, Cleveland, and Dayton to camp there. I had great parents, and they were fun, so before the people would leave, they would reserve their cottage for the next year. Every day at 2 o'clock, the kids and parents who wanted to go swimming or boating would meet by the streetcar station. We could all swim from age 6 on up. My folks were good swimmers. Christine, Lucille, and Ada Kinkley were my country cousins, and when they visited, I would try to teach them to swim. These were the exciting times.
After the Hamiltons discontinued their management of Edgewater in 1914, Whitney retained ownership of the park until 1917. When another of the park residents decided not only to manage it, but also to purchase the entire operation. John Hoagland, a local businessman in Salina for many years, purchased the property from Whitney in April of 1917.
John A. Hoagland was born in Hoagland Township, Van Wert County, Ohio, on October 3, 1860, and is a son of John W. and Margaret Hoagland Byrd. On January 8, 1889, he was united in marriage to Elizabeth Beersdorfer. W.W. Height has purchased J.A. Hoagland's interest in the Ruxell Drugstore and is now the solo owner and proprietor of the business, the deal having been concluded today. Mr. Hoagland will retire from the active business in Salina to assume ownership and control of Edgewater Park. It is his intention to make extensive improvements in Edgewater in due course of time in the way of erecting cottages and providing for the entertainment of the summer cottagers. The Height and Hoagland Drugstore pictured here was located on the corner of Market and Main Street. In more recent years, Schindler's Drugstore was in operation. Today, on the same corner is Lawler's Flower Shop.
Under John Hoagland's management, the park began to grow as a summer retreat for people. And it grew for the next 4 years when John Hoagland sold the property to a group of investors from Greenville. John Hoagland was 60 years of age at the time of the sale. In March of 1920, the Standard printed, Edgewater passes into the hands of new owners. J.A. Hoagland makes final disposal of beautiful park east of town to Greenville purchasers, but will make ready for the summer season. The final transfer of Edgewater Park was made Monday to its new owners, J.A. Hoagland selling the property for $16,000 to Mercer, Tiford, Jeffers, and Ackerman of Greenville. The former will be in the manager in charge and assume care and possession at once. Under J.A. Hoagland's ownership, Edgewater saw steady progress and improvement as popularity as a place of summer residence became assured. It is one of the prettiest park sites in Ohio, situated on the shores of Grand Reservoir and with a magnificent forest affording shade and shelter from the summer's heat. 10 new portable cottages will be added at once to the park to meet the demand of accommodations for summer tourists in quest of a retreat along the water's edge. I would like to thank Lee Fisher and his mother for the pictures of Edgewater Park and the articles that she had written years ago and saved them, fortunately, and Lee shared them with us. Thank you, Lee. We were also fortunate to obtain a name over a year ago when we were doing the grocery store series. Someone called, I don't recall who that was, and said you might be able to obtain some information from Mrs. Clarence Art, whose parents, the Polskams, operate a grocery store, one of the two grocery stores in Edgewater Park, in the mid-teens. And so I called Mrs. Art, and in fact, her parents did operate a grocery store, actually her mother, started a store in a cottage in and around 1915 and ran the store in the summer months only until about 1950, where they sold it to a Harmon family. We spoke to Mrs. Art.
I am Mrs. Clarence Art, the former Emily Polskamp, daughter of daughter of George and Mary Gast Pulskamp. I was born in 1910. And when I was 5 years old, my dad purchased this cottage so that we could enjoy our summers every year, which we did for many years. But as we got a little older, my mother decided she wanted to have a little place of business. And this cottage, which formerly belonged to Dr. Rodebaugh and his wife and family, was up for sale. So they bought it from them. And a number of years later, Mom decided it would be a nice place for a grocery store. So she had the store put in, and we kids were the clerks and helped out on the work end with it, keep the pop and stuff iced up. And it later on then, of course, they added some extra cottages, which Mom and Dad rented to people from an awful lot of Cincinnati, Dayton, Hamilton areas. And we kind of all looked forward from one summer to another at seeing the people again, which also happened. They enjoyed the fishing and the boating and the swimming, of course. And at first, the beach out there was really nice. It had trees on it. There was a lot of sand for kids to play in, which they all did. And there were no offsets or anything that they needed to worry about. So later on, they built a diving platform for the older ones. But I didn't learn how to swim until I was 5 years old. The senior members of the family had swimming lessons, but they said we were too young.
It was
closer to the lake, actually.
Oh, really?
It?
Yeah.
Then Livingston.
There was only about a square from that cottage, about one square from the cottage to the interurban tracks, and then just a short distance to the dance hall, and then on down to the lake, about half square.
Now, the interurban, was it running?
Oh, yes. Yes, because we always had a few weeks of school left when we moved out there. We were out there usually for Decoration Day, and school didn't get dismissed till early in June. And if the weather was real, real bad, why, we would get on the trolley, and it took us to Market Street downtown Salina.
So you rode the, you're the first person I've talked to that's ridden the interurban.
Of course.
Well, he ended at Main Street and...
Yes.
Yep, and entered in Main, and he backed up
Market.
To the...
Yes, it was very convenient. Of course, it cost a whole nickel to ride on the
train. Now, where did you live? You came out there for the summer. Where did you live?
We lived on North Walnut Street.
North
Walnut. The Catholic Church is just a block and a half south of us.
Okay. So you lived on the other side of Wayne Street?
Yeah.
North of Wayne Street.
Yeah. About a block and a half from the Catholic Church.
When did the interurban, do you remember when the interurban...
Started?
Stopped. Yes.
Oh dear. I can't... it stopped long before you...
Yeah, I never rode it.
And there was this little waiting station. This little waiting station was there in case of bad weather, and you could wait there, and then you had to flag the trolley in order to be sure that they would stop for you. Mm. So that's how we got to school and oftentimes church on Sunday.
Now, when you say you got to school, did you have like a token? I mean, you had to pay a nickel or...
Had
to go
be
to
a nickel, if I remember correctly.
Yeah, paid to go to school? I wouldn't have much of a class.
Let me tell you.
We didn't ride the trolley very often because we were a big family, and Dad and Mom couldn't afford it. Of course, we didn't have an automobile either. The only automobile rides we got were on a Sunday morning. Dr. Richardson knew that we would always go to church, and so he would very kindly pile us into his car. And he had a great big car, and it had these folding curtains that you put up, and had isinglass windows in them, and oh, it was a neat big car. But he always would say, "Now, no, you can't walk. I'll just get in the car and I'll take you." So he was a very gracious neighbor.
Here, between Saline and Edgewater Park, let's say, were the interurban backed up and turned around somewhere around where Traditions Restaurant, somewhere right
just
in there.
West of that was the interurban where they backed up into.
What was between there and Edgewater Park? Was there anything out in that area at that time?
Well, you always had out there by the Saline Manufacturing Company. It was on North Enterprise Street.
Okay.
And then you had cottages down on Enterprise south of Market, or on the interurban. There were some cottages down there along the way.
Well, the Otis Hospital was on our way that we had on Market Street.
So the Otis Hospital was there at this point?
When was that established, though?
Well, I don't recall just when that was established, but wasn't the Otis Hospital there then? I know Mr. Carlin and his family lived on the house next to the hospital deal. And he also had a newspaper, which he published. But his was an English paper, where my dad had the German paper.
And that was again called the what?
Der Bote, D-O-T-E. It is on microfilm at the library.
Okay.
So I've got a piece here, or a paper published in 91.
There, at Edgewater Park, and as far as what you remember as the amusement park, had it begun yet? Was there anything there besides cottages in, let's say, 1920? So that'd put you at 10 years of age.
Well, it probably had that square dance hall, and that was probably there, wasn't it? And the Green Lantern.
Was the Green Lantern?
Back at the grocery store, the park grocery store.
See, that was the first dance hall there. It was called the Green Lantern.
We've got a great picture of that.
Yeah, there is a picture of that
there. I've got a great picture.
And then Tieford's, D.O. Tieford and his wife had a dance deal. That was strictly square dance. That was across the street from the Green Lantern.
Your mother run the store?
Mostly.
Mostly. See,
yes, with us kids. But Dad, after all, had his newspaper work.
Yeah, okay. Started off in a cottage, and then this picture right here is that in this?
How old would Ben Rapine be? Bernie Rapine.
Look at him.
Well, no, I mean,
he's a year younger than I am.
Well, okay.
So he's 61.
Well, then we had the store before that.
Yeah, sure.
Because here he is, just a little tyke, and I remember.
We're talking about 1933, 1934, somewhere in there.
Well, he's probably about, what, 3 or 4 there?
Late 30s.
Yeah, right.
Maybe, yeah.
I was born in 33, he was born in 34, so I mean, it was before 40, that's right. Probably
37,
38, right.
And this would have been when Dave Myers' father,
Merle,
purchased it somewhere right in that area, I think. Late 30s?
Yeah, probably somewhere around.
Now, who owned was there an owner of the park?
Before?
Hoagland, John Hoagland.
John Hoagland, okay.
Yeah,
he owned it from like 19, He's 17 got his, on, I believe.
He's got his name on the...
Yeah, well, it's a long time. I don't know what...
On that slip about my brother. And
now, did you know John Hoagland?
I did.
Well,
yeah.
I knew the two boys you raised, Bud Wilson and...
That was Paul.
John, or Paul, well, Paul Wilson, yeah, and Paul Bud.
John
and
became Father John Wilson.
And Father John Wilson, who was in the death march, you know,
yeah,
with the Garmin.
Yeah.
John Hoagland raised those two boys when he lived out at the park. That was his summer home out there at the park. He had a big home there on Hamilton Street.
An article says that he would like to upgrade it, so there was something there when he got it. And he bought it with... There were some cottages there.
There were a number of cottages there.
Okay, maybe that's all it was.
I think so.
And John was probably the man who started the ride, some of the amusement?
Don't ask me. I remember Grandma taking us over and I got to ride the merry-go-round, but I don't know who owned it.
That was when Myers owned it.
Yeah, that was when Burl Myers owned it.
They used to have a guy come from Indiana with the popcorn stand and have it right there just... south of the Green Lantern there, he'd talk about it. And then they had a merry-go-round. I don't know what
that thing was. Oh, they had a merry-go-round.
Well, they had a shooting gallery.
And they had the...
A shooting gallery, yeah.
Oh, it was just like the main walk at the fair.
Yeah, right.
They had all kinds of concessions.
Amusement,
yeah. And they had a chair plane thing that... played the same music over and over and over again. And they finally moved it out to the waterfront so these chairs could fly out over the water more or less and get a little more of a thrill than just going round and round. But the music was terrible. Same thing over and over again.
How about the big dance hall?
Did Temple tell you anything about the big dance hall? Did they tell you that Joe Kane had a pleasure boat, and Joe Kane owned Pullman Bay? He started Pullman Bay. You know where the Harrelsers is now. I mean, when they had all Pullman cars in there, he started that. Then he had a pleasure boat. He stopped over at Edgewater in that bay there. You know where that pier runs out from the dance hall. And then he'd park there on Saturdays and Sundays while he'd take people out and give them a pleasure ride for, I don't know, a dollar I think it cost. They go out on the pleasure boat.
I think I have that picture of that boat. Matter of fact, I think it was in that...
the Ocala?
I'm not sure what...
I
want to back up to the Pullman Bay. Every time I talk to him, I learn something. Now, what was the Pullman Bay, you say he started at? What was that?
Well, he got some old Pullman Bay cars, railroad cars, and started a...
Converted them.
And rented them out to the people that wanted to spend a vacation up here fishing. And then there was one, Red Everman, built his own cottage on a...
You mean he converted the Pullman cars into cottages?
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh!
But he didn't change.
Well, he didn't change much on them, but he just converted into where he could sleep.
Would I love to have a picture of that?
No.
Wouldn't that be something?
Oh, it would.
Well, see, I never understood how,
That's
Pullman
where
Bay.
You got the name Pullman Bay.
Well, that's
okay. Pullman God. Cars.
There's got to be a picture around. Now, I'll put a plea out right now, and somebody will call me.
I'm sure somebody's got it.
Yeah. There has to be.
Yeah.
I often wondered if Mildred Hamilton... She used to be Mildred Hamilton. She married Mr. Fisher. They had a son named Lee. I don't know if you know.
I know Lee.
I remember. Okay.
I know Lee.
Well, her parents had a great big tent that they would pitch or raise or whatever you want to call it in the property next to Mom and Dad's. It had a floor on it. And they stayed in that for many, many weeks during the summertime. And they had the two daughters, her mom and dad. It was Juanita was the older one, and Mildred was the younger one. And as youngsters, we thought that was just super, living in a tent, good heavens. They she cooked out there and everything. It was really something.
Yeah, Lee helped me out on when we were talking about all the Fisher stores that were.
Oh yeah, sure.
He had tons. As a matter of fact, I should probably get those albums because this Mrs. Hamilton had book after book of pictures, and but I wasn't looking for anything at that point except for things on the grocery store. But maybe I should contact her because
you might. Mike.
Oh, I have to get that Pullman picture.
They tell you about the cottages down there right now, which was west of the Pizza Hut. There was a cottage owned by Charles Ellis, and then there was one cottage owned by Fred Fortin, and there was a cottage owned by Herman Vilken down along there. And they're probably them places are still there.
Yeah, there's several of the older ones there.
They were homes, though.
They were homes. But then Ellis rendered them out later on as a cottage, I mean.
Now, what did these people do? You mentioned them by name. What did they
do? Charlie Ellis was a rural carrier out of the post office, and Herman Vilken was a foreman in the veneer department out of Mercer's. And who was the other one I mentioned? Fred Fortman. Fortman's Grocery. And he lived above the grocery in the wintertime and then out up there at the cottage during the summertime. He was quite a bass fisherman.
Wow,
well,
that's nice.
He lived on the corner of Walnut and Market Streets.
Yeah.
Well, that's where the grocery store was.
That's where the grocery store was.
Well,
they lived above.
They had.
It's now the Society Bank.
Yeah, theirs wasn't just a cottage, more or less. It was more like a home. Howard Leffler is another one who, I don't know if he built that home. He built it for his brother-in-law and Howard's sister, Elsie Hilberg.
One interesting note here, Mrs. Art mentioned Howard Leffler building some homes in Edgewater Park. He was also involved in building boats, and he built the cruise boat for Claude Getman somewhere around the mid-1920s, and Claude operated that for several years. The boat itself was built in the winter of 1925, or we think that to be the winter, and it was built in the Gus Jackson garage, which then was located at the corner of Anthony Street and Cherry Street, where there's a big brick building now, and I think it's a gospel coffee shop. But that's where that boat was built, and it was built by Howard Leffler.
At Edgewater, roughly from 1910 till the store sold to the Harmons in 1949.
Yeah.
Give or take a year.
Yeah, somewhere right in that area.
Okay. Yeah.
And then Harmons ran the store, do you remember that? Till
yes, they had the store for quite a while, and they enclosed it, and we thought they ruined the appearance of it completely, but they could have it. Well, I guess they lived
year
in
round.
It. Yeah.
They tried to run the store year-round then?
Yes. Yes, they did.
And when your mother ran it,
just a season. Yeah.
Starting in end of May or
Decoration
Day to Labor Day.
And there were some campers who stayed around later, and as long as the snow wasn't flying, we'd stay out there too. We loved it out there.
They had a pretty nice clientele of people that came, because Mom left her silverware out there in the cottage and there was never anything stolen.
No.
So that's pretty nice clientele.
Yeah, and they'd come back year in and year out. It was always the same people. Yeah. This one family came after an absence of about 10 years or more, and they came up and called Mom by name, and they said, "I bet you don't know who we are." Mom looked at him, and she said, "Oh, yes, I do. You're Mr. and Mrs. So-and-so." She named the kids, and she said, "And you had a dog, too." That was her.
So she ended up having like seven cottages besides the store?
Right.
We rented 7 cottages, and then we lived in the back part of the store. That was our cottage then for the family.
Now, the bait shop that was west of Theo Temple's, well, where Theo later lived, who lived there?
The bait shop, I don't.
You remember the bait?
Bait. Oh, the bait shop.
Was it there at this time when you were there?
No, in the wintertime. He went back to Cincinnati. We worked for Bill Schutz. Worked for Procter and Gamble,
but he just came up.
He just came up in the summer months.
But I'm talking about in the 20s. He was running the bait shop.
Is what?
In the 1920s, was he running the bait shop?
Yeah, I would say right around 25, somewhere around there.
The big dance hall.
The big dance hall came
next to the lake.
Let's see what time of the. What year was that when they put that big dance hall in?
I don't know.
I know I was too young to go to the dances yet. At least my parents thought so.
Well, it was before 27 because I was graduated in 27.
Yeah, I graduated in 28 too, so I know it was before that time. Quite a lot. Quite
I
a
think
long
right time. Around 20, 21.
Probably.
Okay. So when was the first time you went into Edgewater? The dance hall.
Well, I was in high school before we were allowed to go in the dance hall where we weren't allowed to. Not because it was a bad place, but because my parents felt the stipend to get in was too exorbitant.
What was that? Remember that?
I don't recall because we never got to
$5
go.
$5.
Yeah, but when you have a big family.
Now you mentioned the big family. How many were in the family?
There were 8 children, but one died in infancy. The second child died in infancy. Otherwise,
and all the kids worked in the store?
Well, whoever mom could rope into it. But we all took our turns, no schedule.
How about we're talking in the 20s and did you have ice in the summer?
We had ice brought in chunks.
Who brought the ice in?
Oh, the Hemmert
who ice else? Company.
Yeah, they sawed their own ice on our lake and stored it.
Who delivered the milk?
Well, Spicer brought us the milk and the ice cream as well. Well, Mom had different companies for ice cream at times, and Pop the same way. And McKernan Brothers brought in the company and the smokes.
And candy and stuff.
Not cigarettes. I don't think Mom ever sold cigarettes.
Cigars
and chewing tobacco.
But I smoked all them.
It takes a lot of thought.
How about the war years? Do you remember?
Yeah, that's when my dad's business more or less fell apart because he was not permitted to print the legal notices in which there was quite a bit of money involved. And so he reverted to job printing. But he kept on in a print shop and he finally moved it down to the Winter Building on South Main Street. And that's
the Candlelight Inn.
Yeah, now where Candlelight Inn is.
It was they tore down the building that he was in, because I remember that one once. There was a man that had on one half of it was China and what was the name?
Antiques.
Yeah, right. What was the name of that guy?
Murphy.
And Grandpa was on the other side of it.
And the whole back end.
Grandpa. And the Wanamaker's garage was there. And,
and
then on further down, we used to have Blossom's. He was a barber down there. Lived, and his brother, Charlie Blossom, had where Richardson's pool room was on Main Street. In a 100 block south Main. And when we'd go get a haircut, he'd give us a cigar box to take to down to his brother's, and we'd get a nickel for taking that cigar box. And then they got somebody coming, a kid coming along there, and then they'd take the thing back to the barber shop. They'd get a nickel.
What were they transporting?
They never knew.
Just, he wanted to be good to kids. He knew we needed to be poor people.
I see you carrying an empty box down for a nickel, huh?
Why not?
What was the barber shop? What was that?
Blossom's barber shop.
Oh, that was what you...
And they had a picture in that barber shop I always admired. It shows the dogs sitting around the table playing poker.
I think everybody at one time owned that picture, you know. I've seen it everywhere. That block where the Candlelight Inn is now, and where your father was in business, do you remember the stores just to the north in the next block?
Right across the street from that Murphy's, I call it a junk shop, was a theater. Right where it's an empty lot now, and it was owned by Louis Wall.
I was just going to say, didn't he have his...
Louis Wall was there too, but before yeah. Louis Wall, there was a theater there. The Rex, I think they called it.
Oh my goodness.
I was just a little kid then.
How about, do you remember the grocery store that was right in that area?
Across the street on the west side of the street, on Main Street, by the alley where Crone Tire Supply used to be. That used to be a grocery, Joe Smith.
Right.
Oh, yeah, and he had a...
And in fact, right across the alley from them, there used to be a theater there, too.
Remember that name?
Huh?
Do you remember the name of that theater?
I don't know. No, I don't remember what the... It just seemed to me that one of them moved to... Either that one moved up here or this one moved down there. Is what. But I remember theaters there.
What else was in that block? Was there a... Wasn't there a...
There was a tin shop and Booz's photography.
Oh, I have some picture. I have some ads on that.
Yeah. There was a tin shop. I forget who run that tin shop. I mean, you know, made spoutings and stuff like that.
So, when your father was on South Main Street, that was
300 block.
Okay, was that before? Was he down there before the war?
No,
we better qualify which war we're talking about.
He was just
He used to
big one. WW2.
Yeah, well,
he used to always get the printing job of the voters, you know, the ballots.
Uh huh.
And then they helped him out, numbering them and everything.
Numbered them and put them in book formation.
So what are we talking about? I was confused. I was on the wrong war, possibly, huh?
Well, yeah, because he stopped publishing the German paper in the First World War,
1918.
I was a war off in several decades.
But he kept his print shop going.
In the same location there?
Yeah, okay. Until, he was kind of stricken with rheumatism and so forth. Then he moved his smaller press. He had a little press and a medium-sized press. He moved them to our garage on North Monmouth Street. And he had that in operation for several years, not too long. Yeah, you remember that, don't you?
Oh, I remember him being on South Main Street.
I've got a picture of a press that is very similar to the one he had on which he printed the German paper. So if you are interested in taking a gander at that, why, I'll have to dig it out from under.
Okay, after, he apparently was down on South Main Street for a number of years then, wasn't he?
Oh, yeah.
When did he quit working or
No, he always, he would solicit work from certain people. He was, Dad was kind of proud, I guess you'd call it. He didn't like asking people for work, although they liked his work immensely, but...
Yes, you'll have to get the standard out, his obituary, and read that when they said.
Yeah, I've got that too.
You have that here?
Yes.
Oh, I love it, yeah.
The funeral mass for George Polskamp, 79, former publisher and commercial printer here in Salina, will be celebrated at 9:30 a.m. Monday in the Immaculate Conception Catholic Church, followed by burial in the Catholic cemetery. Mr. Polskamp passed away at his home, 619 North Walnut Street, at 10:30 a.m. Friday after a long illness. A native of Moriah Stein, he was born January 12, 1873, the son of the late Herman H. and Anna Mary Schaefer Polskamp. He came to Salina with his father, who was a former probate judge, and was graduated from the Salina Public Schools. Later, he entered the college, or the University of Notre Dame, and was graduated with the degree of Bachelor of Literature. He served as an apprentice at the Standard Printing Company under the late A.P.J. Snyder. In 1899, he purchased and took over the management and publication of the Mercer County Bodie. By midsummer of the same year, he was united in marriage to the former Mary Kathleen Gast. After hostilities ceased at the conclusion of the World War I, he discontinued the publication of the Bodie and continued business as a commercial printer. In November of 1948, due to physical disabilities, he retired from active business.
When you weren't, I know where you shopped for groceries in the summer, but when you were living back on Walnut Street, what store did you shop?
Well, let's see, where did Dad go? He had Meservey's.
Well, you used to have Hecker's Meat Market.
Well, that was Hendricks.
And Hecker and...
George Hendricks.
And Shunk. And George Hendricks' grocery store there.
Yeah.
And then there was Schmalz.
On Anthony Street.
Yeah, well, right around where the monument.
Yeah.
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 Then Small Stick up on North Walnut.
Yeah.
Tavel.
We got a lot of our meats and things there. And milk. Well, no, milk we got from the country. We had a little trot after that.
Yeah. Well, I know both those stores, well, all three of those stores.
Well, they used to get a lot of stuff delivered by Fred Fortin from Fortin's Grocery.
Yeah. But we didn't.
They delivered.
We didn't go shopping like they do now. As kids, we were allowed to go to Fisher's or Mo Hendricks mostly when I was young.
Well, Frank Fisher was right close to you.
But Frank Fisher. Years ago, it was on Main Street, right next to Slinker's Saloon or Restaurant. Well, Slinker's Saloon was on one side, and Slinker's Restaurant was on the other, and then came Frank Fisher's Meat Market.
Yeah.
But Dad did all that. See, we didn't have a car, and we didn't go trotting after groceries. Mom never went shopping.
You didn't have a car? Did you have a horse and buggy or?
No.
Nothing, just walk.
We had a pair of legs.
Yeah.
Yeah. Well, she'd send the kids for it, and if it was more than Dad wanted to carry, then he had Fortman's Grocery deliver.
Well, how did you move your stuff in the spring when you went out to the lake?
You know, I've been wondering about that. I don't recall that, because we moved our piano every blessed year out to the park. And in the fall, then we would have it moved back.
You had to have somebody like old John Gibbons or somebody like that with a trailer.
Like McMurray.
We had these music teachers. It was May, Matilda, and Agnes. Came from St. Mary's. And May was the pianist, Agnes the violinist, and Matilda the celloist. And one or other of our family all took lessons once a week. And it cost Mom and Dad 25 cents, I think it was, for a lesson, music lesson. And my brother, the oldest brother, reaped a good harvest out of that. He ended up going to Chicago Musical College as a result of the constant practicing sessions.
Did anyone ever perform in any of the dance halls or the...
No.
Well, now, didn't Uncle Andy play for the
movies? Yes, he played...
The silent movies?
He played for the one theater in town for... I think that was probably when he was home for vacation from college.
Now, which theater? Is that on Fayette Street, or...?
No, let's see. Yes, I guess it was.
Well, there was one on Market Street, too. Strand or something like that.
No, he didn't. I don't think he played for that one. I think he played for the other one on Main Street. And
Lake?
The Lake was on Main Street. The Ohio was on Market Street, and the Fayette was on Fayette when I was a kid.
Well, some of the sheet music and stuff that I gave you to give to Vicky, well, that's some that he used when he was playing.
So he played during the silent picture.
Just like they portrayed
here.
You know,
when the villain is getting, you know, how excited
oh,
and
kids
all that
get
kind of
all.
Stuff.
The louder the better when there's in trouble.
That's fascinating.
Yeah. It was, although I never got to go to the movies. I went to two movies, I think. And of course, we go out to Edgewater Park, and nobody came in to go to the movie from there, that's for sure.
Oh, you had the rides and the
Brother, I went to a lot of movies every Saturday afternoon. None of these serials would go by, like Perilous Paul's Affairs and then William S. Archer, the Two Gun Cowboy, and I mean, all the cowboys back then, I mean, Tom Mix and all of them. I saw almost all the movies. And bought my ticket, was setting pennies up and rolling for them, and then keeping the penny, and then setting another, the other guy had set up another one, and as soon as I'd hit one, I'd keep it. I mean, and I'd get 10 cents that way to go to the movies.
Big price to pay for a movie.
After the war.
Which war?
World War II, when I'm getting close to where you're sold the store. Were the kids gone? I mean,
yeah.
And so it was just too much.
I was married, had a family, and
that was when my sister and I used to take over cleaning the cottages.
Oh, I forgot about the seven cottages.
Oh yes, they had to be.
Well,
cleaned.
I clerked in the store too. It was a big honor and a thrill to be able to,
sure.
Sell people things, make change, and act like I was big
now,
stuff.
Now, did this store operate like some of them? Where you shop for the people they brought a list in, or did they kind of browse through? Do you remember?
There was no browsing.
They
came to the counter.
And
it was just a small.
Ask for what they wanted.
And you got
Mother didn't have a big array of meats and baked goods and such. She had the eggs and butter and the staples. Yeah.
Yeah.
And
coffee.
Bread.
Flour.
Yeah.
Bread. Candy.
Well, I wish they'd bring back those stores. They might as well bring. They'd be better off if they just took my list and filled it up for me, because I asked them so many questions. The time I get out of the grocery store now, they'd be probably time ahead just to fill my list and send me on my way.
Yeah.
You remember this day that the store sold?
Well, yes. It happened when Dad was in a wheelchair. He was having problems, I don't know if they got it before he had his amputation or after he had his leg amputated. It was right in that area. And he lived it must have been before he had his amputation, because he lived 5 years after the amputation, I think.
Oh, I know.
Oh, they
know.
Really.
It's kind of sad when you stop and think about
really
it.
Really bulldozed it down. I said the one building that housed our store, that was old. And number 7 was pretty old. But the ones that Mom and Dad put, number 1, 2, 3, and 5 and 6, those were all from new lumber and everything. They were built
by... So you guys built those?
They had them built by Howard Leffler.
That original store, then, you're talking maybe the almost the turn of the century?
I would imagine, probably. I suppose.
So the store was in...
Yeah.
When it was a cottage.
Do you remember who he bought it from? A doctor, you said, from St. Mary's?
Dr. Rodeball. He was a dentist.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. Yes, I knew the family. It was Josie was his wife's name, Josephine. And it was Audrey and Daisy Bell and George. They had the 3 children.
Now, the big dance hall, you know, you weren't allowed in the 20s, did it attract the big name bands that time too, like it did in the 40s?
I don't know about that, but
I was in the 40s when they tried the big bands. I mean, what they did was they play in Cincinnati, say for instance on a Saturday night, then they'd come up here and they'd stop off here and play here just like a jam session, you might call it. But they, it cost you to get in everything, you know. Mm-hmm. Then they would go next day, that night, yep, they'd go to Deep Ride. This was like a stop off and resting spot, too far to go in one within a bus, you know, they figured. And then they'd get kind of practice. And there were some big bands. I don't remember just who the, all was here, but there were some big bands. But I was pretty.
Now, who are these people? And is that along the lake?
That's my mom and dad, yes. That was along Edgewater Park there that used to be kind of high there, and they were sitting up there. Just a nice place to walk. And there were three little clumps of, we called them the Three Woods. You could walk on the beach and you go through Woods 1 and then walk a little further into 2 and 3.
At this point, I would like to sincerely thank the arts for their stories, their time, the pictures that they have saved all these years, and for the information that we were lacking on what Edgewater was like in those early years and even the very beginning years. It is something that I greatly appreciate, and I think now the story of Edgewater is becoming much clearer. I know that at this point, after John Hoagland sold it to the Tiford and Associates, the story is easy to trace simply because there were numerous articles in the newspaper. There was even a weekly article that was written about the Edgewater notes, and you simply have to go back through the Standard at the library and go through and find out in the summer months exactly what was happening, who was playing. But also at this point, Edgewater began to change hands quite rapidly. Tiford sold the park in 1922 and was purchased by the Mayer brothers. And it was at this point that the park really took on the midway atmosphere with more rides, shooting galleries, lots of improvements on the beach. And then the biggest change, of course, was the addition of the dance hall that has retained so many memories in people's minds. And it stood for a number of years after it was idle and was just recently torn down in recent years. And even though it was torn down, there are lots of things that were preserved from it. The dance floor went to Sydney, and Tom Judy put it into his home down there. And the lumber was dismantled and taken out, and some barns and other buildings were made out of it. And lots of people stopped by and took souvenirs. Lowell White's has the old marquees, both of them on each side of the door, and Charlie Ayers has items taken from Edgewater. And we will be showing you those, and also some of the things that were happening at the Edgewater that necessarily weren't good things, such as liquor raids and trolley crashes and an airplane crash and a little of everything, but at least it was things happened there because it was the place to be. Shortly after the Mayer brothers took over, things made a drastic change at Edgewater. On May 7th, 1922 was the grand opening of the Mayer brothers' new amusement park.
The Mayer brothers announced the opening of Edgewater Park, together with the new $10,000 dancing pavilion, for which they have engaged the services of the Syncopated Six, recently returning from a season's engagement with the Gold Dragon Inn at St. Petersburg, Florida. The new owners of Edgewater, the Beautiful, have made a complete cleanup of the grounds. They are in better shape than any previous season, and they expect to maintain the park as one of the neatest and best kept places of resort in Ohio. The cottages have all been cleaned for the season, and each of them are provided with gas and electric lights. In connection with the new dancing pavilion, the managers, following the custom now prevalent in Ohio, will have a dance matron at the pavilion upon the occasion of all dances. There will be none of the freak dances. The coddle, the shimmy, the moonlight dances will not be permitted. Due decorum must be maintained. People who do not dance are invited to come and hear the music. Dancing Thursday and Sunday evenings. By grace of one day of fair weather, capacity crowds attended the opening of New Edgewater Park both afternoon and evening Sunday.
Thanks, Harry. This is Count Basie, and we're coming off of New York City. We're going to make New York really jump. That's right, and it's a 1 o'clock jump.
Managers Mayer and Ammon estimate that over 1,000 persons passed through the gates of Edgewater Park on Sunday, the official opening of the North Shore Grand Reservoir Resort. The big dancing pavilion, redecorated and still more brilliantly lighted, was crowded. Good music was furnished and the dancing was under the direction of George Kistler, who will place the ban upon freak dancing. Mrs. Earl Ammon will also chaperone the dancers, which will be the special feature throughout the summer. The boats in use at the park have been painted white, and a fleet of them are ready for use. Besides the freak dancing that was upsetting to some citizens of Salina in those days, there were also some other uncommon occurrences that caused turmoil. When J.A. Hoagland was manager of Edgewater Park in the summer of 1917, he missed several boxes of chewing gum. At the time, he was inclined to suspect home talent and gave it no further thought until the following letters reached Salina this week and were handed over to him, together with the sum enclosed. Chief of Police, Salina, Ohio. Dear Sir, please address and mail the enclosed letter to the man who operated Edgewater Park during the summer of 1917, if possible. If his address is unknown, please return the letter to the sender. Yours truly, Howard Tomlinson. February of 1923. Dear Sir, enclosed fine $2 in payment for some chewing gum which some kids stole from your stand at the Dance Hall Pavilion during the summer of 1917. I did not take it, but I might as well have, for I chewed some of it. Also a nickel for a towel which I secured from the man who ran the towel booth during the summer of 1921. He gave it to me, but I did not pay for it. Yours truly, Howard Tomlinson.
There were also more serious things happening at Edgewater. The churches were upset at Edgewater Park because they were allowing Sunday dancing. And there was something also upsetting to the churches and to many of the people of Salina, and that was the sale of liquor and alcohol. Consequently, there was a big haul made here Saturday by dry detectives of bootlegger suspects. Eight lodged in county jail at an early hour. Men who made the arrest successfully disguised identity until they got the man. Five men arrested on a charge of bootlegging were locked in the county jail Saturday morning. The men are Ed Peek, Ben Adams, Virge Dixon, Scotty Johnson, Martin Birch, Fred Bauer, Liberty Township, Chris High, Rockford, George Lilich, Rockford. The big haul of suspects was made Saturday morning. At 6 o'clock, the quintet was marched uptown and placed behind bars. For the past 2 weeks, five men, two detectives from Detroit, and three state sleuths have been camping at Edgewater Park. The five visitors were plain clothes and gave no clue whatever to their identity. They were here to fish and recreate, and so nobody gave them any special attention. It is further said, however, the five men lost no time in becoming acquainted with several well-known places along the shores of Grand Reservoir and also with some of the town residents suspected of buying and selling liquor. The out-of-town visitors frequented the haunts of the men suspected of bootlegging, gained their confidence and insight in their way of dealings. Immediately after the first haul, the dry detectives departed on another errand going in quest of suspects. State prohibition inspectors and federal officers made the investigation at Sline and brought about the arrest. The hearing of the men charged with the grave offense of defying the laws of the state and the federal authority was begun at 1:30 Saturday afternoon. The arrests were made in Sline and elsewhere in the county are in accordance with the nationwide movement for the enforcement of the prohibition laws. Men who defy the provisions of the 18th Amendment are nowhere exempt from the state and national surveillance, and while open defiance of the law may apparently pass unnoticed for a time, there is always a time of reckoning. The 18th Amendment can in no way be construed as a dead letter law. Besides the law enforcement officers, both state and local and federal, being upset with Edgewater, and apparently some local wives were also upset with Edgewater, and the churches were upset with Edgewater. There were lots of neat things going on at the park that were entertaining and delighted many who lived in this area. On April 2nd of 1923, the new ballpark, the Mercelina Park, was opened. Work on the new ballpark has started, and by Wednesday, the big fence surrounding same will be completed, and work on the new grandstand will start. When finished, it will be one of the most modern grounds in this part of the country. The stands will be one of the very newest type, seating 800 people. It will be U-shaped, being 90 feet front and 147 foot back. Only four posts will obstruct the whole front, as the roof will be held up by big iron cables. Last fall, several hundred dollars were paid out to grade the ground, and as soon as the dirt is in shape, work will begin in leveling up some. When finished, it will look like a floor. The opening game will be played on May 13th, and the Cons of Elkhart, Indiana, will be here to pry off the lid. The Cons are one of the best semi-pro teams in the state of Indiana and represent the Cons Limited Company, the largest factory in the world manufacturing band instruments. As a special attraction, they will have with them Conn's great band, composed of the best musicians in the country, also Robert Bruce and his quartet. Robert Bruce is known the world over as one of the leaders of the Pershing band in France. The band and quartet will give an hour's concert before the game, and this alone will be a big attraction if you do not care for baseball. To make it more comfortable for all, cushioned seats have been brought, and all those going in the stand will have the use of same without extra cost. And if you didn't like baseball, or if you didn't want to listen to the music, you might want to enjoy watching a new dance called the Ting Tut Dance. It was due to premiere at Edgewater that evening. If you didn't like to dance or listen to music, there were tons of other things to do at Edgewater Park, and one of the things that in this area that people loved to do was watch baseball. And this team that played in Edgewater in the late 20s and 30s provided much entertainment to not only area residents but all over the countryside. This team had the distinct pleasure and honor of playing against such greats as Lou Gehrig and Babe Ruth. Not only did Edgewater now have a new ballpark, it also had a new dance floor, at the time cost $10,000. And this is what Edgewater today is very famous for, at least by the majority of people that were there. This is what they remember, the big swing bands that stopped off on their way to other cities for a Sunday evening of music. And thanks to Theo Temple and a host of other people of Salina, they preserved a tremendous part of Edgewater's history in scrapbooks and on their walls, and picking up knickknacks and memorabilia from this famous dance hall. Those interviews and trinkets and pictures of every name band that played across America will be aired in a later episode on Edgewater. But from 1923 to 1929, Edgewater thrived. It was the pioneer amusement park in the area. It wasn't the only park, but it was probably the very first amusement park. But in the 20s, there was also a park beginning at the east end of the lake called Gordon State Park. And that had a tremendous success and probably somewhat of a downfall to Edgewater. Gordon State Park had the luxury of the trolley car being the first stop before Edgewater. And so many of the passengers got off there and remained there. And it thrived until a fire in the early 30s, wiped it out. But Edgewater survived up until about 1929. And like so many other businesses across the country, the Depression took its toll on those, and in particular, Edgewater. The court records show that even though the transactions were numerous, from 1923 to 26 or 27, it thrived. Mayors were the main instigators of that success, and at one point they split their partnership with their brothers, and they sold it to a Jeffries, and a Jeffries in turn sold it later to a Mon, and a Mon mayor ended up selling it back to a brother. But for the 5 or 6 years, it flourished. The Midway was unique. It had rides and shooting galleries, and if you didn't like the swing bands or the big bands across the street, you could go to the square dance hall for country music, and there was another dance hall. And there were dozens of boats that could be rented for fishing or rowing. There was an incredible beach, and later a wall and a boardwalk along the beach that had a slide, and as Mrs. Art told us, as some type of swing that would whip you out across the water. So there were lots of things to do at Edgewater, and it was fairly inexpensive unless you wanted to possibly go on the cruise boat that Howard Loeffler built for Claude Getman. And it ran about the same time Claude Getman died in 1929, and the boat excursions along with the park pretty well had fizzled at that point. It's one interesting note about that boat, though, is that it is still not in the lake, but near the lake today. It's turned over on its top out east of Salina, but it still is around. If you look at the court record, you will see that in the 1929 area, things were starting to apparently take its effect on Edgewater and its owners, and there were some judgments and some liens placed against the property, and it pretty well fell idle. But it was idle from roughly 1930. You can see that there were liens placed against it by City Loan and the Salina Lumber Company and the Citizens Bank. And finally, in 1937, there was a sheriff's sale, and Carey and Burl Myers purchased the property kind of on a whim or a fluke one afternoon. And we would like to not end on a depressing note about Edgewater, because it was an exciting place, a place that has stirred a tremendous amount of memories and fond memories of people who grew up in this area. And we would like to suggest at this point that the next series that we're going to do will once again bring out those fond memories, because that is the time we're going to bring back the swing bands and the music of the time period and the people who went there and the interviews that we had with people who lived for Sunday evenings when the big bands would come into town, and whether they were inside or out, they still remember the sounds. And that's what is so amazing about doing all this research, and you hear these stories, and they all have pictures, and they all have memories, and they all have great thoughts about their childhood and their youth. But one thing that in the older historical pieces that we have done, one thing that is missing, and that's the sound. And Edgewater must have possessed an enormous amount of sounds to people. As Mrs. Art said, the constant repetition of the merry-go-round and the music from the twirl-a-wheel that whipped the kids out across the lake. And the sounds of that Pullman or the inner urban train coming through Edgewater on its random excursions. And the sounds of horses and buggies being pulled across streets of brick and clay. And we can't bring those back, but I'm sure those sounds have been stirred watching this, and the sounds that must have come from the great dance hall truly had to be exciting to witness and to hear firsthand, and to see those great, great band leaders that stopped off in this little out-of-the-way place to play and perform to people who never have forgotten or have never will forget, and will share those memories with people for a long, long time. On the next episode of Edgewater, we will share those with you.
myself a big boy. 'Cause he's just the type a gal respects. He's the strongest weakness of the weakest sex. See that strut, ain't nothing else but that big boy.
Edgewater was tangled in legal matters in the early 30s and pretty much was left idle until 1937, when the local sheriff was forced to sell it at public auction on the courthouse steps. Burl Myers, by chance, was walking across the street, according to his son Dave Myers, when he heard the local bidding.
As I understand it, that Dad was going across the street to the courthouse. At that time, his offices were in the Wyckoff building. And as he was going across, there was a sheriff's cell being conducted on the courthouse steps. And he hesitated and listened and found out that this was the sheriff's sale of the Edgewater Park. And different people were bidding. And so he thought it sounded like it wasn't really a lot of money that was being offered. Of course, back in 37, a lot of different times, but in any event, he ended up the high bidder and bought Edgewater Park and did not have any idea that he would ever bid on it. Okay, well, after Dad bought the park, it was in terrible shape, the weeds were high, and a group of us, old Bill Baggs, Bob Pierce-Thorpe, Charlie Kimmel, myself, went out with hand scythes and did cut a lot of the weeds, and the some cottages there and other buildings, which were also in need of repair, and Dad had a lot of carpenters come in, a whole group of them. Some of them I don't remember their names, but they came in and immediately started to repair and fix it up so that it could be get into business. And Ted Hall, as I recall, was the first fella that Dad had to manage the park, and he managed that for some time. And then I ran it for one summer, in 30, well, I can remember that very well because I ran it. And when the park closed in 39, started in 39, and my wife and I were married then, while we closed the park there in September of 1940, and for the winter. Now, Bill Bakker, I believe, then ran it for a while, and then Theo Temple came in, and he and his wife Marge continued to run it until the time it was closed.
A person is lucky if his or her work lasts a lifetime. Luckier if their job is at the same location, and downright fortunate if it's the only job they had ever really wanted or ever dreamed of having. Theo Temple had such a job. He managed Edgewater Park in all of her glory, an Edgewater Park that is so fondly recalled by so many people who live for summer Sunday evenings when the dance hall doors open or the wooden windows covers raised, and the glorious sounds of all the major big swing bands drifted over the dance floor and escaped out the windows and disappeared into the night above the lake. Theo Temple was a man who had the distinct pleasure of hiring and booking and talking and paying all those major musicians of the big band era.
I'm the former manager of Edgewater Park. I started my job here in 1941 under the direction and ownership of Burl Myers and his family.
What did you do when you were...
Well, as manager, we had dance hall, two dance halls, in fact, 30 cottages that we rented in the summertime. Beer garden, and at that time, a skating rink, which only lasted a couple of years. The skating rink was turned into a dance hall. And we had a boat house, a bait house. We had 25 rowboats at that time, because rowboats are the thing. I mean, very few motorboats. Has changed over the years, and as the motorboats became more popular, we put a boat ramp in for the boats to go in and out of the lake, and it's still in use, belonging to the Moose Lodge. It's still over there, still used all the time.
What do you think made the park so successful?
Well, at that time, it was hard for people to travel far. The war had started in the 40s, and they just couldn't go to Lakeside and Cincinnati, Toledo, like they do now. So they went to the smaller parks, and smaller dance halls, whatever they could find.
And you say they did people come from out of town to Edgewater Park?
Yes, in the summer most of our cottage business was from Dayton and Cincinnati.
How did they get here? Like, did most drive?
Oh yes, they drove here. There was a while that they had trouble getting here because of the stamps needed for gasoline. That was during the war.
So did the interurban play a big part in transportation then?
Not at that time. That was before the 40s. The interurban had been taken out.
Okay. How did you book your entertainment? You say you had two dance halls, one originally, and then you transformed the skating rink into another one.
Well, the what they call a square dance hall was used by... We used local bands for that, and for the big hall, I booked bands through General Amusement Company, American Company, and several booking agencies that had bands going through this part of the country. And whenever they would have a good, what they thought was a good deal on a band, they'd call me and we'd try to, and we'd set up a...
So what were some of the big names that performed here?
Well, the first one was Stan Kenton on his first trip to New York from California. And it was a big success. So from then on, we started booking bands. We had Jimmy Dorsey, Tommy Dorsey, Louis Armstrong, mental block right now.
Well, I'm curious as what in the world did it cost? I mean, these names aren't, you know, to Sasha and to most of my students mean nothing. But what, these were the biggest names in the world, and they're coming to Edgewater Park, Slidell, Ohio, during the war. What in the world did it cost to have a group like that? And would they perform one night, two nights?
One night stands. And we were very fortunate to buy them cheap, because they would usually play in Cincinnati or Detroit someplace on Friday and Saturday, and then Sunday is an off night. Very few places played on Sunday.
Right.
So we were able to buy these bands at a third or a fourth of what they would be paid on Friday and Saturday. In other words, to get a band like Louis Armstrong, Duke Ellington, Count Basie, the Dorseys, $1,000 was all we had to pay.
Oh, goodness.
And, of course, that was when money was a little...
And you're talking about an orchestra there. I mean, you're talking about $1,000 for the entire group.
The entire group.
Now, once they got here...
Where did they stay? Yeah, where did they board at?
Well, about the only good place for them to stay here, if they stayed here, was at St. Mary's.
Mm-hmm.
There was a hotel right on Spring Street there. I don't know if it's still there or not. And they would stay there. And a lot of them, though, were in, you know, they traveled in bus. They would go to the next city that they were playing.
Oh, okay. And what type of crowd did it attract? I mean, were there a lot of younger people or older people or both?
Both. But it was nothing like later on when you had rock and roll bands.
Yeah.
Then it was all young people. The older people would not come. But when we had these name bands, then we had old and young. I mean, by young, I mean 18, 20 years old. From there on up to doctors and attorneys. And
when did you start getting the rock and roll bands in?
In the late 60s.
So, how long did you work at the park?
Till it closed.
Till it closed. And what year was that?
That was, when was it? 70.
It ran the night.
Around 70 when they put
the new highway,
and that closed the park.
They ran the highway through the park?
That's where it was, yes. Oh. Right through this.
How many acres was involved in this park? Do you remember that? I mean, that's something we can find out from the...
Didn't any of those cards
tell? I think it does.
Look at them. Check the backs on some of those.
This much.
But there would have been 20-some acres, I would judge. Because I just...
Is that what closed the park, the highway?
Yes.
Well, Well, this is kind of interesting. This is one of your cards that you would send out that had the information on the back and the reservations and...
Oh, dear, but it doesn't say that.
No.
The acreage.
It says 50 modern cottages. Your deposit.
Mm-hmm.
17,000 acres.
Yeah, so I can't tell you.
Well, we'll look that up. Yeah, that's not a problem. See, these are cards now that I'll need to insert. That's great.
Well, you had that merry-go-round picture,
yeah.
Didn't you?
Not this one. This is the first time I've seen these.
What was the most popular thing at the park? Was it the dance halls or was it like the merry-go-round?
The merry-go-round and concessions. Rides, things like that, were only used on weekends, like Saturdays and Sundays and holidays. And we had about 10 different, well, we had a shooting gallery and penny pitch and high striker, all those things that your fairs and now
seesaw. The park was open. Parts of the park were open all year round. Is that correct?
Dance halls were.
Dance hall now.
And the grocery.
Who ran the grocery?
We owned it and we hired the people to operate it. And it, besides a grocery. We had about 15 arcade machines in the building, in the grocery building, which brought a lot of younger people, an arcade machine.
Yeah.
Now, you know, most of the things are, well, everything's gone now. But when I was a kid in the 50s, I still remember riding my bicycle through this area, and there were still the rides right across the street. And I remember Bill Fence, Bill Fence chainsaw place and lawnmower mm-hmm. place. Wasn't that, in fact, the one of the dance halls?
That was, right.
That was the square dance?
Square dance hall.
All right. I saw a picture. I have a picture of that. And that was where Bill Fence operated for a number mm-hmm. of years. And it seems like, was there a building right across the street at one time? Was right. that like a...
That's the one that we called Dance Land. I think you had a picture of that. I know it may not be there, but there was.
I did see that one that said Dance Land.
Yes.
Dance Land was the big dance hall?
No, this was just, this was the other dance hall, the square dance, the square dances. Now the big dance hall we had, there were most of the time, and in the summer we would have Thursday night, Saturday night, and Sunday night dances. Mm-hmm. But only one night would be a big name band, the other band. The other nights would be local bands.
Did you draw just as large of a crowd with the local bands as you did the big name bands?
Oh, no.
And what was a typical crowd on a Sunday night with Tommy Dorsey or?
A thousand
people.
You could say 1,000 people.
What were the tickets to get in?
2 to 2.5. Never over 2.5. We never had anyone with all the best bands in the country.
Was the park, which was right where the Eagles is mm-hmm. currently under construction or getting ready to break ground for their operation, was it something besides dance hall? Did they serve food?
Oh, yes.
Oh, see, I never knew that.
Right east of the dance hall, when what was a parking lot mostly. There was a big first-class restaurant there for years.
Now, did it have a name?
It burned down, but it was there for years.
And you managed that too?
Well, I released it to someone. In fact, Pauline Van Tilburg, I don't know if you remember her, she was running it when it burned. She operated it for several years.
Remember the name of it?
Oh, it had different names according to who was operating it.
That'd be interesting if we could locate
Yeah, I don't have any pictures
I've never seen a picture or an ad. Now, we're finding tons of ads. Just tons of them.
Yeah.
But that would be interesting. Maybe we can find that out by maybe Jerry Barger, which is a granddaughter, a grandson of Pauline.
And then at one time, east of this big restaurant was a filling station, a gas station. We closed that in about 45, I believe, because...
Couldn't get gas, huh?
Gasoline problems. Yeah. So
did the war present a problem to the park, or was it thriving during the war years? It seems like it'd be
it
a great...
It thrived, yeah.
People wanted a place to go, yeah. Didn't they? Would find the way to get there.
Hard to buy soft drinks, hard to buy beer. It was a problem, but people would put up with it.
So what is your favorite memory of the park? Just one thing that you remember the most about it? Or one specific time?
I remember one night following a dance. Duke Ellington played here. He and my father-in-law, who a lot of people will remember, Henry Herman. And Henry and Duke sat and talked till the band was ready to leave and everyone in the dance hall was closing, and they still were talking. Finally, we moved them on. But I thought it was one of the nicest things that I had seen. You know, we just don't have too many black people around here, colored people, whatever you want to say. And Henry, he might have been mayor at that time. You know, he was mayor one term. But I know they had a beautiful talk.
Well, it's just as amazing. Here, you have met every great big band legend that ever existed in this country. You've met them all.
Almost all of them.
And you have an autographed picture. We have tons of those.
Yeah, and you had some from right around close here. We had Gene Krupa. He's from Indiana. Yeah. You have his picture. Great memories.
Did you have some of them like Louis Armstrong? Did they return? Did they ever come back?
Yes. They all played several times.
Now, the big band, let's say when you took over in 1941, how long did that go? Did it go 5 years, 10 years that you booked big bands?
Well, let's see. We were still booking big bands up to the 60s.
So 20 years, this had to be this was a famous place.
You had some of those cards.
Yeah.
Did you have anyone call you and ask to play, like if they were going to be passing through, or was
they didn't do that directly,
through
but
bookers.
They would call through the booking agency.
Oh, okay.
And they were in the area, then they just, this was a popular, they knew that people would come and see it.
Right.
Oh, that's fantastic.
And then later on, we had some of the big names in rock and roll.
Tony Orlando played here, I saw that.
Who was the first one? Made the big, big hit. I can't think of his name right now. There were several of we had several.
In the new highway, did that? I mean, in the 60s when things were slowing down,
right?
What was the real cause of it? Was it the road wasn't in yet? Was it hadn't come through yet? Had it?
I would say that the big reason, and a lot of people probably argue about this, was rock and roll music. because, like I said before, rock and roll music would bring out the kids, but not the older people. Then you'd have a regular band like we had been having. The older people would come, kids would not. And then during the 40s and 50s and their early lifetime, they came, the kids.
And they mixed
with
well.
The old. They mixed well, everything was fine.
And then they separated when the music changed.
When the music changed, that was it.
Well, is there anything else that you'd like to add?
Oh, we tried about everything here. We even had wrestling down at the...
Oh, my God.
You were the big contender, right?
Well, we even had one championship match, and now we had a man out of Toledo. I had very little to do with this, other than renting the hall.
Yeah, he was in the dance hall?
He was in the dance hall. He would come in and set up his everything. Of course, we had plenty of chairs and places, and
would be perfect for that because you just dance.
But it was quite an entertainment. Drew good crowds.
I have this was, say 20 acres, and I think 13 or so different things going at the same time. How many people were employed out here?
Oh, it would vary.
Like in the peak summer season?
In the summer, well, there would be 40.
No,
probably 40, 35, 40 people.
And like in the dance hall that you ran, did you run that with someone, or was it you and your wife, or?
Yes, my wife and I ran the dance hall. And,
how about the dance hall across the street? That was under your management yet?
It was under my management. I didn't spend much time there, but we had the band that we hired and someone to run the thing.
Remember any local musicians that would sit in with
Charlie Cheney had the first band when we came here, the first square dance hall band. Well, we had a 30-passenger pleasure boat that used to come and go. Do you remember it?
I remember, and we have a great picture of that.
Yeah. And the Myers boys had a speedboat that they took people out for rides.
There it is.
Yeah. That was theirs. And,
Can you think back to the first day that you began working at Edgewater Park, what your impression was? How?
Well, I knew what it was before I came because I had been here, mm-hmm. Coming over to, and so when I had the my wife and I had the chance to move in and take over, we were very happy to do it. And naturally, we've made a lot of changes, which everyone does when they start a new business.
What about your last day? Do you remember what you felt then?
The last day, well, I had seen it coming a long time after the road. It was very nice. In fact, this home was part of the park. And when it came time to move on, the Myers boys sold me the this home and lot. I'd been living here. They said, well, you can buy it. So
you've lived here since
1944. How old were you when you started working at the park?
Well, 40, you see. I was born in 14. You see, I'm 80 years old. So I was born in 1914 and moved over here in 41.
Okay.
So, you're mad.
27 years old. What did you do before you managed the park?
Oh, I worked for the state and state highway department most of the time.
And
did some painting with my brother. My brother was a painter. I helped him. I'd gone to school, went to college one year. And then started working for the state.
If there was one thing that you could have preserved from the park, be it material or just memories, what would it have been?
Well, of course, naturally, my best memories are the dance hall, what happened there. I have some memory things from the dance hall.
Mm-hmm.
That was the most important thing, I thought.
And it survived the longest, too, didn't it?
Yeah.
It survived to the very end. This would be a different route.
And Mr. Myers was very easy with the money. I mean, the money we would make there, we would spend other places to improve other parts of the park.
Well, it sounds like you were fortunate to have a job that you look forward to going to every day.
Yes, we enjoyed it. My wife and I both enjoyed it. She had worked at the auditor's office at the courthouse, and when we got to working here, we liked it very much because we were working together.
Mm-hmm.
It made it nice.
Put the side flaps up, and it was a screened area all around the building, and a lot of the teenagers of the area would gather outside. We weren't old enough to get in, and we would listen to all of the stars of the day, the big bands that were traveling the country. Now, you've got to remember that in this period of time, these were the bands on the jukeboxes, on the radio. We were listening to the music that was popular. Glenn Miller Band, and Louis Armstrong was coming in, and Count Basie, and Duke Ellington, and Stan Kenton, and just all of the big bands of the day were playing at Edgewater. It was very common for them to travel. Well, right here in Ohio, we had Carousel Ballroom close by, and Crystal Ball, and Eldora Park, Terrace Gardens in Van Wert, the Moonlight Gardens up at Russell's Point. And there were big bands every week someplace, and we kids could tell you who was on the band. We knew who was playing drums. We knew who got traded from one band to the other, just like students do today with baseball players or anything else. It was romantic out along the lake with the moon shining off the water, and here's all these fantastic big bands playing. It was just something that we wanted to be a part of.
So when did you first start working at Edgewater?
Well, I started playing professionally at a very young age. There was some nice people in the area. Paul Miller ran the local music store at the time. He was a tenor sax player with the Bobby Wirtz Band. And George Zoller from here in town, a fine trumpet player who was working with a number of groups. I think George played with Bobby Wirtz and Don Smith. And Lowell Weitz, now Dr. Weitz, was playing around the area. These guys got together and sponsored a high school dance band. We couldn't study jazz or big band music in the schools, so they got together and they crammed us in the front of the Salina Music Store, and they gave us their expertise and taught us how to play this kind of music. And we had kids from St. Henry and Coldwater and Salina and all over the area that were getting together and playing. And of course, we couldn't wait for the next rehearsal to play In the Mood or whatever big band tune was popular then. So I started doing that as a freshman in high school. And musicians back then, I'm talking about the early 50s, 51, 52, would take you kind of in a mentorship. They would take you under their wing. We went along to dance jobs and sat right alongside of them and played the music that they were playing, and they would point out things and help us and tell us how to get better. It was a real apprenticeship type of situation. Today you can't do that. They don't have that opportunity, but we got to play and have a great time and look forward to the Saturday night big band dance. It was a neat experience.
So who was the first band that you ever played with?
Oh boy, that's tough. Probably the Jimmy Baldus Big Band. They worked out at Crystal Ball in Frenchtown up by Versailles, a huge ballroom with the chandeliers and all of that, and this group played for ballroom fancy dancing all of the time. That's back when people danced together instead of 4 miles apart. And we would go along and like I said, kind of apprenticeship. There were two or three of us almost every week. I believe Lowell Weitz was playing in the band at that time. And a lot of fine musicians from this area. Bill Brandon, one of the fine tenor sax players from Salina, was playing in the band, and a trumpet player by the name of Cooch Sensenball from Montezuma was just a fantastic trumpet player. It had offers to play on the road with big bands, and Cooch, I think, was an Ohio State grad, was an awfully fine trumpet player. But that kind of started things rolling for me. I joined the musician union at about the time I was 14 or 15 years old, and have played pretty well professionally ever since that time. It gets in your blood. You kind of can't do away with that.
Which dance hall did you usually perform?
Well, in this area, we worked a little bit of everywhere, but the Edgewater was kind of the mecca. That was where you, in New York, you go to Carnegie Hall. In Mercer County, we wanted to go to Edgewater. That was the place where all of the big bands were coming in, and so it was the idea as a young person, if you got to play on the same stage that Harry James or Glenn Miller or somebody like that, like, wow, you were really doing something. And there were, like I had mentioned earlier, an awful lot of dance halls in the area, and with so many bands. There was the Bobby Wirtz band out of Sydney. There was Don Smith band out of Rossburg. Hank Sellhorst band out of Coldwater. Dale Bear here from Salina had a fine group. Just a lot of bands in the area, and as a young player, if one of their regular players couldn't make it, I got on the substitute list, so to speak, because I was going along anytime they were playing anywhere, I'd always go up with my horn and say, can I play? And because they were nice individuals and wanted to pass on their art, they always let me set in. Well, if somebody got sick and couldn't make it, or had a family occasion or something, couldn't get there, they got in the habit of calling me. So I got to play an awful lot before I was ever out of high school, and that was, oh boy, that was neat. That was fun.
What do you remember about the people who worked at Edgewater?
Oh, geez. You talking about the temples, the people that ran the park?
Or
the musicians. Okay, well, I'll start with the temples because they were nice people. They had to watch out for all these young kids out here because we idolized these bands and stars that were coming in. And what we did often was after everybody had entered, why, we would go up and beg them to let us in and promise that we wouldn't try to buy a beer or anything. And then we'd hide off in the corner where it was dark. But they knew that eventually we weren't going to be in the corner. We were right down in front of the bands with our mouths wide open. And as soon as the guys in the band took a break, why, we were all over them because we wanted to talk to these, you know, stars and get autographs. I was never an autograph hound. I just want, you know, what kind of sax are you using? What kind of mouthpiece? What are you doing? Where have you been? And they were very patient with us. They were very, very nice to us.
Speaking about buying things, how much do you think, do you remember getting paid for?
Oh, well, I start off with a chuckle because some of my friends here in town that I have played with for many, many years kid about the fact that we used to make a very small amount playing, and we would spend more after we got off the dance eating breakfast, buying a steak and eggs or something, than we had earned for the whole evening. It wasn't uncommon to pay for $6 or $8 a night, not an hour, a night, and that was normally a 4-hour dance. And then pretty soon we got into the big time and we made all of $12 or something like that. That was before Musicians Union came in and helped organize things and got a little better pay for the musicians. Not trucking against dance hall owners, they wanted to make their amount, but the musicians, in many cases, were the people that were drawing crowds to the hall. And the musicians were not getting a very,
Mike Gale, come to the office, please.
Very
Mike Gale,
strong
come to
amount
the
of money. In later years, you can make a very comfortable living being a professional musician. Today, that is not the case. Live musicians have been replaced by karaoke machines and disc jockeys. Disc jockeys will go out and charge to play a wedding dance or reception about the same amount of money that people could buy a live band for. It's hard to get a live band to play the top 40 rock and roll tunes, and so most people prefer the disc jockeys anymore. The crowd at Edgewater and the other dance halls was quite unique by today's standards, because you had granddad, grandmom, the next generation, and their kids all in the same dance. I mean, this was very common. The children went with their parents to dances. You don't see that anymore. And everybody was together. So there was a sponsorship by the parents of the young ones, but they were teaching each other to dance. You could see, you know, the young daughter dancing with grandfather and enjoying it and learning the different dance steps and all appreciating the big band songs and singing along. Today, I'm not so sure that grandparents would want to sing some of the lyrics and the songs that are popular. But back then, everyone could accomplish that, and the family aspect was really neat. It could be, across the generations, so to speak.
What's the famous band player that ever performed at Edgewater, and the most famous that you sat in with?
Well, that's a little tough to answer because I enjoyed all the different styles so much. I have a lot of memories, like Lionel Hampton dancing on top of his drums, and the Count Basie band when we had an electrical storm and the lights went out and the band never stopped, kept right on playing, even though they had all this music in front of them. And eventually the lights came back on and the band kept right on going, and the whole crowd stood up and applauded for them because they had never missed a beat. Of course, what most of the people didn't realize is these guys had been playing the music for 12, 15 years. They had everything memorized, and didn't matter whether the lights were on or not, they weren't paying a whole lot of attention to it anyway. But I guess, that's tough because I was in love with every group that ever came in. The one that brings back some good memories, Stan Kenton had a very unusual experimental type of jazz band. They played dance tunes that were very popular, but the Kenton band had a sound that nobody else had. And of course, I've got some after-hours situations. Stan Kenton got arrested in Salina.
He happened to meet a young lady at the dance that night. I guess today you'd call them groupies, someone that really enjoyed the band. And he offered to take her out for dinner and brought along a bottle of whiskey and was seen getting in a taxi cab with the young lady and the bottle of whiskey, and the local police arrested him, rightfully so, no problem there. But that got a nice giggle in the musicians community that Kenton had gotten picked up and gotten arrested. That was an outstanding band, and many of the players in the Kenton band went on to be famous leaders themselves. Maynard Ferguson, that we still hear about today, is an outstanding high note trumpet player that was with the Kenton band. Probably my most memorable experience for me personally was I'd had about a year and a half of college in Florida and had to drop out to go to work, and I had a job at New Idea. And Sunday night, this was early in the spring, the Ralph Flanagan band came in. Flanagan was the type of kind of a copy of the Glenn Miller sound. As a matter of fact, he'd played some piano with the Glenn Miller band, a very fine pianist. And as I got there that evening, I noticed immediately that there was a sax short. Most bands have five saxes in them. And there were only four up on the stand. Well, I guess maybe normal people wouldn't understand that, but we musicians traveled with a tuxedo in the car and our horns, just waiting for an opportunity. So I was right in the door. And went up to the bandstand and went right brazenly up to Mr. Flanagan and said, "Hey, I'm a sax player. You're a short one. Would you like to have a sax player tonight?" And he said, "Sure," and stopped me cold. So I quickly got into my tux, got my horn out, and came and played. If I'm not mistaken, Dr. White's Lowell also played some that evening. Flanagan, like I said, was a very fine pianist, and he, in the middle of tune, pretty sure this is the same night, started changing keys and doing some weird stuff, trying to throw off Lowell's bass playing. He didn't know that he was working with the pro, because Lowell followed him like fingers in a glove and just copied everything he was doing. And at the end of the tune, why, Flanagan admitted defeat, that Lowell had done a super job. Well, I believe Lowell had the offer to go on the road with the group. I'm not positive of that, but I think that Flanagan had offered him the job as bass player. And lucky enough for me, he also offered me a job. And I said, I had to shave off my goatee. I had a goatee. I wasn't allowed to wear the goatee. I remember that. And I said, "That's not a problem. That's not, I'll take." Anyway, I went back to New Idea on Monday morning and said, "Geez, I'm sorry, but I'm not going to be able to make corn pickers anymore. I'm meeting Flanagan Band in Cincinnati on Wednesday." And I went down to Fountain Square Hotel on Wednesday in Cincinnati and joined the band. And that was the beginning of about a two and a half year span of playing all over the country in various big bands. It was a rather glamorous time for me as a young man. That was fun.
And so when you returned, what did you do?
I came back and went to school and taught at the Salina Music Store, and went to school and taught in the Salina Music Store. Married Pat, my wife, who was at the time selling records and working in the Salina Music Store, and finally got a degree and became a band director. Worked at Bodkin's for a couple of years and have been in Salina. I think this is something like my 26th year in Salina, and now I've had a chance to pass on a little bit of what the nice people did for me. We've had jazz band programs here in the Salina City Schools for a lot of years, and a lot of kids have had the opportunity to learn about this big band music and travel some. We get out to hear other big bands, and any chance we get to watch a video or listen to records, well, we do a lot of that too.
To jump back to your pre-stationary years, what was it like being a musician on the road?
Oh boy. Well, can you imagine being 19 or 20 years old and being single and traveling all over the country to all these glamorous ballrooms and all these cities? I worked in Chicago and Denver and Miami Beach. It was hard not to be really thrilled. You're working with fine musicians. You're earning your living as a traveling musician. And this was something that had been a childhood, you know, dream. I want to be a baseball player. I want to be a fireman. I wanted to be a musician. And so it was nice. Now, there's a downside of it. We happen to travel in station wagons. And you played the dance, and you got off maybe 2 o'clock in the morning. We'd go out someplace, eat breakfast, and we'd get in the station wagon, and we'd travel. Well, now, you're traveling at 3 o'clock in the morning. It's dark. It doesn't matter whether you're in Ohio, New York, Iowa. Dark means you can't see anything. You pull into the next large city, and you go to the hotel, and you check in. You wake up maybe after lunch sometime, and downtown Philadelphia looks like downtown Chicago or downtown Denver. And you hit the restaurant, you go to a music store, whatever. When we were on location, when we stayed in one town for a while, when we stayed in Chicago or we stayed in St. Louis or wherever, that got to be neat because on our nights off, we could go out and listen to other musicians and talk and catch shows. I spent, quite a while in Chicago. And there was a lot of jazz groups in Chicago, so that was a lot of fun. We got to do that. It isn't all glamour. The married guys that were traveling, a lot of them brought their wives along. I don't think any of them had children that I can remember in our band. But back in the 50s, late 50s, big bands started to break up because dance halls like Edgewater we're not drawing the crowds anymore. Rock and roll was coming in. The big band sound was going away. There was additional costs for traveling. And when we started, we were traveling maybe a couple hundred miles from here to Toledo, from Toledo to Cleveland. Well, then it got to be from Cleveland to Chicago, from Chicago to someplace in Iowa. And that wasn't quite as glamorous anymore. The band leaders that I played with a number of times, they flew, but we rode in station wagons. So that took a little bit of the glamour out of it, but it was still a good living and a tremendous way to get experience. Miami Beach was probably the most thrilling. This was back before the invasion times, and we got to hear all the Latin American music and the Cuban music coming in. And I got to work with Arthur Murray's wife, Catherine, with the dance group for a while. And there were a lot of, you know, Miami Beach is a great place to be young with the night blooming jasmine and the beautiful palm trees and the moon over the ocean. And again, you know, we're talking about youthful person having fun with these friends running around the country. So it was neat. It was a nice way to make a living.
Well, it sounds like you had a wonderful
life. I need to preface what I say today with two things. First of all, Theo Temple, who ran the park, has probably forgotten more about Edgewater Park than I'll ever know. Secondly, what I say is based on observations from someone who was a kid seeing something that he enjoyed through the eyes of a kid in that situation. So my views are probably stilted or prejudiced. It's kind of like the kid that ran 90 yards in a football game and scored a touchdown and described the game as the greatest time in his life. And the guy sitting next to him in the stands said, well, you know, the game was, same game was okay. It's all in your perspective. A lot of what we talk about here today is a story in itself, so the stories may be abbreviated. But I should mention right off that I should bring into everybody's attention Bob Lorig, because he's done a great job with the bands at Salina, and he was a definite part of Edgewater's memories. In fact, I was at Edgewater the night he auditioned for Ralph Flanagan's band and left with them. After he left, Bob used to send me postcards. And he was one of my students at Ohio Northern University when I was on the faculty there. And he was a very good student. For those that don't remember Ralph Flanagan, And Sasha, you probably don't remember Ralph Flanagan or anybody remotely related to him. He was originally an arranger for the great Glenn Miller, and you may not even have heard of Glenn Miller, but Glenn Miller was a very prominent band leader during World War II. And then later, Ralph formed his own band. The night that Mr. Lorridge, or Bob Lorridge, went on the band at Edgewater, the band had been in an accident getting here. A lot of people don't know this story, so I'll relate a little of it to you. The bass player was hurt, and his bass was smashed up, so I ended up sitting in with the band, and I played all evening. I still have some letters and cards from Ralph asking me to come on the band, either on bass or trumpet, which I did for a few months at a time later on. At that time, it was hard for the road bands to get musicians because the traveling was so uncomfortable. Now, Ralph, the band leader, had his own airplane, so he flew everywhere he went. But we peons, we had to tough it out on the bus. To give you a little idea, Bob, what this agenda was like, when I say tough it out on the bus, the last week that I was on the Buddy Morrow Band, we were in Albany, New York on Friday night, Athens, Ohio on Saturday, Indianapolis on Sunday, Chicago on Monday, Milwaukee on Tuesday, and Colorado Springs on Wednesday. And Thursday morning, I quit and came home to sign up for graduate school. I had enough of the road bands for a while. Well, after I came home and had signed up for graduate school, I had already moved to OU, which is in Athens, Ohio. And my dad called me there and said, Buddy called from California and wanted me to meet the band there. So I called him back and I thanked him. And I said, I appreciate the offer, but there's not enough money to get me back on the road at this time in my life. I was exhausted. So I went on to school, and the band went on and played the Jimmy Rogers show in L.A. on the national TV show. And the bass player, which I was playing bass at the time, the bass player and the drummer and the piano player stayed in that studio band. For all I know, they may still be there. And that's how close that I and a lot of other people like me came to getting a studio job, which is the dream job for a musician. Another Salina teacher that I should mention was also part of the Edgewater gang, or the alumna, or whatever you want to call us, was Denny Ransbottom. And there were a lot of musicians around here who played in or had bands that were affected by Edgewater's influence and were often there as listeners. Some of the names that come to my mind are Chet Grimm. Chet still lives over on Hemlock Street. I think he gets his horn out once in a while and sees if it's still there, but that's about the extent of it. And Don Coyle, who is a fine guitar player. Hank Selhorst, who runs the sweeper place uptown, I think. Hank had his own band. He was quite a guy. George Zoller. A lot of people know George and still remember him. Dr. Louis Froning. If you ever had your teeth worked on in Dr. Froning's office, up in the Wyckoff building, you'll remember him, but he was a fine, fine trumpet player. In fact, he, I think, played trumpet in Bob Lorridge's big band, the West Ohio big band that Bob had here for a while. And then there's a number of great guys that have passed on that I should mention. A lot of people will remember Walkie Davis. Everybody knew Walkie. He was just a terrific guy. Bill Haslock was a fine guitar player. Dick Reisner was a drummer. Corky, I think, was a drummer in the marching band here at Salina, his daughter. And one guy that I really want to mention was Cooch Sensenball, Gerald Sensenball. Cooch was from Montezuma. And he was first chair, first cornet in the Ohio State Marching Band, or excuse me, the Ohio State Concert Band. Now, there were a whole bunch of others, but I apologize for not being able to remember them all right now. But there's a lot of them around. This all started with the Salina Music Store. When I was a kid, I had a motivation toward music that was very strong. And this was heightened by the fact that there was no TV, And entertainment was listening to the radio. My kids still ask me if they had electricity when I was young. Or going to one of the three theaters that were in Salina. At that time, there were three. That was the Lake, where Rankin's is now. The Ohio, which was close to the downtown Society Bank. And the Fayette, where the Salina Music Store is now, which was on Fayette Street, naturally. By the way, you'll appreciate this. The Saturday matinees, when we used to go to them, were a nickel. And then I believe the Lake Theater was a dime sometimes, and the Ohio, which was down on Market Street, was 15 cents. That's what it cost you to go to the movie. And a lot of times, a lot of the kids couldn't come up with enough money to get in the movies. When the other theaters closed and the music store became a reality, we spent a lot of time there, primarily because a lot of musicians that played in bands, etc., were usually there and playing their instruments. I can still remember Larry Evans. Larry was one of the former music teachers here at Salina. He would walk around the music store with his trumpet and play little sections from the Saber Dance and things like that, which was pretty exciting stuff for a kid who lived on a farm and got into town on Saturdays only. Anyway, the music store was first owned by a former traveling road musician, and his name was Nob Bainey. His real name was Norbert, but everybody called him Nob. Nob and Bill Haslock and Al Bruins, that would be Dick Bruins' uncle, if you know Dick, used to run Northmore Marina, and Gutty Amato, who was Jerry Amato's dad, all had a band, and they would come into the store from time to time. Apparently, I was wide-eyed enough so that Nob could see I was a music fanatic, and he introduced me to Edgewater Park. When I heard my first big band there, I was hooked forever. Later, when I was about 16 or 17, by the way, I was in school at Rockford at that time. That was before we had moved to Salina. When I was about 16 or 17, I was there on a Sunday evening when Gene Krupa's band was playing. Now, Nob Bainey knew him, knew Gene very well from when he was on the road, and he talked with Krupa because Krupa was short a trumpet player. And Nob told him about me. So I skipped school for a week. Since my mom and dad are both gone, I can tell that now, truthfully. I skipped school for a week and went on the road with him till he got somebody that was a real trumpet player. When I say Krupa found a real trumpet player, we were all kids then and we didn't play very well, so. But it's a good thing he found a really good trumpet player, because I'd have quit school forever and to keep on playing in that band. That was during the end of or shortly after World War II, when all the musicians were either in the service or in the cities where the action was. Nobody wanted to work on the road because they could make more money in the clubs in the cities. I loved it so much that I would have worked for nothing. And a lot of times I did. And there's no opportunities to break into the music business like that anymore, Bob. It's too bad. It's a different world. But and just as one little tag on the end of this story, a few years ago, Mary came in, my wife came in, shook me at 4:30 in the morning, woke me up, and said, "You had a long distance call, and it was Nob Bainey. And he was calling me from the nursing home in Cincinnati where he was, and he died later that day, and he called me that morning at 4:30 in the morning to say goodbye." That was a different breed of musicians than we have now. They're just a little different approach to life. Now, Bob, I suppose you want me to tell all the dirty stories about this that I know. This is the stamp that was used. When you went in to the dance, they would stamp your hand, and they had a light, a little table lamp, that had a black light in it. And in the pad that they used to stamp was this ultraviolet ink. Now, of course, we being kids then, not having any money, we knew all the dirty tricks. So we found out that Vaseline would glow in the ultraviolet light. And naturally, not having any money, we would sneak in once in a while by pressing some of that on our hands. I can't tell you. You're not going to tell anybody about this.
Oh, now, no, I'm too shocked.
But I thought you might find that's interesting. That's the original bottle, and there's still a little ink left in it. Kind of an interesting story to it. It was sent to me by Roger Dietrich, who is currently the president of the Musicians Union in Lima. And when he was down here as a young fellow in about 1949, which was about the time I sneaked off and got on the Krupa band, his brother Dale was a drummer, and Roger's a drummer also. But Dale climbed up on the bandstand and wanted his picture taken with Gene Krupa, and in the background is my picture sitting there in the trumpet section. So Roger sent me this picture, and I'll read you from the note that he sent me. He said, "I took this picture when I was about 13 or 14. Little did I know who the tall kid, me, was, or that we'd ever be friends. Several years ago, Dale and I were looking at my old scrapbooks, and he said, 'There's Lowell Weitz.' So here's your picture, 30 years late." You're probably wondering why I'm showing you a chair. This was the chair that was in the arcade office where a lot of the band leaders and the guys came in to get paid, that they sat in. When I got it, this armrest right here was missing. An old-time craftsman, wood craftsman that I know, made this one for me and replaced it. This is the original here. And put in all new seat. The old seat was hanging down in tatters, and I think there might have been maybe one of the struts or something was missing here in the chair, but I stripped it all down and refinished it and brought it back to life, so it's as good as it was the day it was made. But there's a lot of famous people sat in that chair.
I'm here with Edgewater patron Charlie Ayers, and we're just going to speak with him today about his memories as a child and as a teenager growing up around these parts with Edgewater Park. And why don't we just start with that? Why don't you tell us about your memories of Edgewater?
Okay, well, of course, my first memories were when I was pretty young with my mother and father, when we used to drive out to Edgewater Park, like on the Saturday or Sunday nights when they were having the dances, and we would sit in the car outside right up against the dance hall practically, and they would have the big wooden shades up off of the windows, and you could see in and you could hear the music, and you could see everything that went on in there, you know. And we'd sit there in our car and just enjoy the music and look in there to see what was going on, you know, and all the people that we knew, just watch them dancing and drinking and talking. And once in a while they'd stroll outside and everything like that, you know. And that was my first recollection of Edgewater Park. That was probably in I was born in 1926, and I was probably 10 years old, 1936 or 34, right around in there, you know, in that era. Then, my second recollection, it brought back so many memories, was when I was in high school. That was before World War II. And that's when we first started going out to Edgewater to dances, because then I was old enough, you know, to get in, and had a lot of acquaintances that went out there. And we would go out on Sunday nights when the big bands were there, and dance, and we'd drink orange pop. I never will forget Edgewater Park when you approached it, or when you were around there, you know, the first odor you got was the kind of the smell of 3-2 beer, you know, which was what the young kids could drink. They had 3-2 beer and 6% beer, which was a little stronger, but they only sold 3-2 beer at Edgewater Park, and you could get that aroma of 3-2 beer and orange pop, and I drank orange pop for a while before I was old enough to imbibe. And the big bands came on Sunday nights, because they would generally come from like Chicago, and they were going to Cincinnati or going to someplace east or going in the opposite direction. And Salina in those days was like on the main route that they traveled. They didn't have interstate highways back in those days.
Oh, yeah.
And they all went on the roads that we know now as secondary highways. And Salina seemed to be kind of a central location for people going from Cincinnati to Chicago or Cincinnati to Cleveland or someplace, you know, or from Chicago down east. And on Sunday nights, the bands generally hit Salina, and that was the big night for Edgewater Park.
So and
we'd go out on Sunday nights and have a good time, and then we stayed till after the dance was over. We never went home early, and we had to get up and go to school next morning.
What time did the dances usually end?
Well, they generally ended around 12 or 12:30.
Oh, gosh.
Yeah, and they started like at 7:30 or 8. The bands played for 4 hours, generally.
Oh, that would be nice.
Yeah.
So who was your favorite band that played out at Edgewater?
Well, my favorite band was Stan Kenton.
Oh.
And he didn't come on the scene until later on. It was about 1941 when Stan Kenton first organized his band. And he came to Edgewater Park on his way from Los Angeles to New York on his first road tour. And I'll never forget that experience of listening to Stan Kenton. I was out there dancing and just enjoying myself, you know, and all at once I heard this music and it caught my ear, and I stopped out, and I never will forget, I was out in the middle of the dance floor and I stopped and looked towards the bandstand, and I couldn't believe what I was hearing. He had five trumpets and five trombones and five saxophones and a bass, piano and drums and a bongo player and a girl singer. And when that band let loose with their, they played pretty loud, and when they let loose with that brass, I'll tell you, it caught your attention. And I stood there just almost transfixed, you know, listening to that. Another period, because the big bands had sort of started to decline in that period, but we still had a lot of them out to Edgewater Park. The a lot of the musicians went to the service, you know, during the war, and when they came back, they had a hard time getting reorganized, and some of the bands didn't go on the road as much as they used to. They stayed in the big cities and everything. But after the war, then I was old enough then I could drink beer, you know, or whatever I wanted to drink, you know, at Edgewater Park. And we'd go out there, and instead of drinking 3-2 beer, the older kids and the older people even some people that were my father and mother's age would all bring a bottle in those days, you know. And of course, it was illegal to sell whiskey at Edgewater Park, so you had to keep the bottle in a sack. You always made a big deal of hiding it under your coat, you know, when you came in the door. And then you had to set the bottle on the floor, and you would go to the counter and get your 7-Up or Coke or whatever you drank with the alcohol in those days, and you'd come back and set the ice and the drinks, the glasses and everything on the table, and then you'd look around and see that nobody was watching, and you'd reach down and get your bottle of the whiskey. And it was kind of a farce because everybody knew that everybody was drinking whiskey just about, you know. And they had a bouncer out there by the name of Fuzzy Grace. And Fuzzy was a short, real heavy set guy, and Fuzzy would come around and look suspiciously at you, you know. And if there was a bottle on the table, he would take and make you get rid of that bottle and put it on the floor, you know. And everybody made a big deal about their whiskey had to be on the floor, out of sight. And in those days, they had a lot of bands on other nights besides Sunday night. There was some on Saturday night too. And we just thoroughly enjoyed that period of time. Another thing too about the music. When I went to Edgewater Park during all three periods, in my younger days, my teen age days, and after the war, you would see all ages out there. You would see the young teenage kids. You'd see their mothers and fathers, and sometimes even their grandparents out at Edgewater Park. Because in those days, everybody liked the same kind of music, you know, and everybody like to dance. Now the older people, they didn't dance much, you know, but I can remember people of my mother and father's age being out there, and there was a lot of those people, you know, and they would dance just the same as us kids would, you know, and we all enjoyed the same kind of music. And that's amazing when three generations practically, you know, could sit there and listen or dance or whatever and enjoy themselves all at the same place, you know. You hardly think of that being possible, you know, nowadays.
So when did East of the Dance Hall, why don't you tell us about that?
Oh, yeah, what I remember, started out as a restaurant. I don't remember what was there before Dave Myers had it.
You remember where it was?
Yeah, I ran that for a while, and
please tell us the name of it.
It was Edgewater Park Inn. Full dinner, sandwiches, steaks, chicken.
Now, is it true that they brought in a chef?
In 1946, I guess it was, that my wife and I came back to Salina. And I ran the Edgewater Inn and managed the park some, and went back and forth to law school. See, I had taken my pre-law at Ohio Wesleyan and then had gone to Ohio State for a couple of quarters, and then went in. But in any event, after the war, which I'd spent the war period of the war at Curtis Wright building airplanes, and then came back to Ohio Northern and re-entered law school, transferred credits and so on from Ohio Wesleyan and Ohio State College of Law, So then I was running that and going back and forth, and a fellow named Carl Shelley rode back and forth with me for a while. And in any event, Edgewater Inn then became a place to eat, and also had a little dance floor there, and had jukeboxes, and served beer, as the park did. I had a license right along with the park. And
what happened to the restaurant?
It burned down, finally. After I started practicing law then in 48, why, the VFW leased the, what was Edgewater Inn, and then they built their own place, and then Pauline Van Tilburg took it over and ran it until it had a fire and burned down.
Do you remember what year?
A lot of, we kept in touch with each other, and we'd go out there and patronize him. Then, after that, that building was bought by the VFW, Veterans of Foreign Wars. And this, of course, was after the war, and when I came home from the service in 1946, I joined the VFW, and I started in college, and when I came home in the summer from college, I worked there part-time as a bartender. And those were the golden days, I'll tell you. We had more fun out there. That was it was a kind of a broken up building on the inside because it had been a residence at one time, but we had a bar back behind on what used to be the kitchen. And the front room, the big front room, was like a dance hall, and they used to have gambling in there, you know. A guy by the name of Loggy Van Tilburg from Rockford had the gambling games, and he would come in once a month, and we'd have a fish fry, and Loggy would have the games, and everybody would come out and bet on them, and they'd play poker and everything like that. Then we had another room, which was sort of a leisure room, and we had one of the first television sets in Mercer County out there. And in those days, the television set was kind of small, and the sound came out pretty good, but the picture was just full of snow. I mean, you had to really tune it in perfect, and then sometimes you could get the picture. And it had a big attic, and up in the attic, we kept cots and different things for in case of an emergency. I don't remember what else, but I remember the cots were up there, you know, and there was some rescue and life-saving equipment up there that was never used. And I tended bar back there, and we really would have good times. I mean, and in those days, I used to sing a lot when I was in high school, and then even when I got out of high school. And the other bartender that tended bar with me was Max Van Tilburg, and he was in the glee club when we were in school too. And he and I tended bar, and we would start singing, you know. First thing you know, all the customers were singing. And we would have the best time. We would sing until we were hoarse, and till they had to close the place up, you know, and just had, it was a golden era, I'll tell you, for us. Those were wonderful, enjoyable, joyous times out there at VFW. That was really, I'll tell you something else about the VFW, too. Every once in a while, we would go to Edgewater Park when the dances were on there and invite the band over to the VFW for drinks after the dance. And some of them, of course, had a schedule that they had to keep and they couldn't come over. But I remember Ray Anthony was a well-known band, and he always came over after the dance. And normally the whole band would come over, and the bus drivers and all the equipment people that would pack up, you know, the equipment, music, and everything like that. And we would have a crowd over there. And, of course, our regular customers would be there mingling with the band and everything, you know. And we always had all they wanted to drink on the house.
Oh, wow.
We never charged them a penny. Nice. We had a good time. And the reason we could do that, it was in those days, the VFW and a lot of the other clubs had slot machines. And they made all kinds of money off of the slot machines, you know, giving away a few drinks to the band members, you know, and things like that. Didn't hurt a thing, and it really created a lot of goodwill. And it drew a big crowd of other people in there because they wanted to meet the band members, you know, and talk. And a lot of people that were jazz enthusiasts, you know, would know each individual band and every member in the band, you know, and they would know their names and they would know their history, who they played with before they played with Ray Anthony, you know, and what their plans were and where they were going, you know. And they'd come over, the band would come over, and we'd sit around and drink and just reminisce and talk and just have a big, just like a big reunion almost, you know.
Well, it sounds like you had a wonderful time.
Oh, yeah. Those were good, wonderful, the golden years, I'll tell you. And we in Salina, in those days, didn't realize how good we had it, you know. We didn't have any interstate highways, like I told you before, and it was, not difficult, but it was a long trip to go to Dayton if you wanted to go to a dance, or Fort Wayne, or Columbus. And when we had the big bands coming here to Salina, right here where we could only, you didn't have to drive only but a couple miles, you know, to see them. People would come from Decatur and Van Wert and Lima and all around, you know, to Edgewater Park and enjoy themselves. And it was the best entertainment that you could possibly get, you know, in those days. Those bands were top-notch. And another thing, talking about top-notch, we had a lot of local bands in those days.
Oh, yeah.
That were good. And they would come and fill in on the nights that the big bands couldn't make it, you know, and then some of them were regulars, you know. They would come like once a month or something like that. And a lot of the local guys around here played in those bands, and they were very, very good. They were professional, and we had a good time then, too. And talking about going downhill, when they tore the building down, you know, a number of years ago, I would drive past there a lot because my office was out that way on Steger Road, and I'd drive past, and every day you could see the old dance hall slowly disappearing. And I would almost cry when I'd go past there. I mean, that was a sad thing. And finally, you know, it was completely demolished. But while they were tearing it down, I would go out there once in a while, and I'd walk in the building and walk around the building, you know, to see. I wanted to see, you know, what it was made of, what the floor was under the floor and everything, and what happened to some of the stuff that was in there, you know, like the crystal ball. They had a big crystal ball, you know, up in the ceiling that would turn, and the glitter of the lights, you know, would shine on the tables and on the walls, you know, and on the ceiling, and it was beautiful. And I often wondered, whatever happened to that crystal ball? I got there too late when I'd walked through there. That crystal ball was long gone, and the tables and chairs were long gone and everything. And I just walked in there, and I could almost hear the music, you know, and visualize certain people that I knew that were standards there, that were there every dance, you know, and I just, it was a sad time for me. Finally, the thing was completely demolished, and every once in a while, though, I still go out past there and think about it, you know, all the good times we had.
And Charlie, you weren't alone. For almost 30 years, people did have fun. Obviously, it was a time that meant a great deal for hundreds and hundreds of people who waited for warm summer evenings and the arrival of their favorite bands. So many people remembered fondly the times they spent at Edgewater, whether they were lucky enough to be inside watching and listening to their band, or outside near the huge screened-in windows waiting in anticipation of the great sounds that would soon escape. And for those brief moments, they enjoyed and stored the sounds that filtered through the windows and escaped into the night above the park that stood at the water's edge. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.